already told you, it depends, the investment you are going to make will depend on the objectives you are going to have for that particular investment, because the needs, the type of risk you are going to take, the requirements, future requirements, these are the objectives. So depending upon all these objectives, you will formulate your policy of investment. So how much to invest, how much to invest in which type of security, these are all going to be the most important and first step of investment process. The second step is security analysis. So when you want to invest, you have to analyze the different securities. Even, for example, if you want to invest in fixed deposits, now there are different rates with the different banks. So as a wise investor, you would like to make a survey of the investments, opportunities available to you, and wherever you are going to get a better return, you are going to invest it there. So similarly, if you are going to invest in equity shares, you have to do the analysis of the company, the background, the future, financial performance. These are very important. Otherwise, without analyzing these things, if you invest, there is a great chance of losing your money. So that is the second part. Then construct a portfolio. As I was explaining in the last session, what proportion of money you want to put it in the government securities or fixed income securities or equity shares or even the debentures. So it depends on the your requirement, your needs and all that. So that definition also you have to make for yourself, and on your own you have to do. Or if you explain all these things to a financial analyst, he may be able to help you in formulating your portfolio. Then, as I told you again in the last session, review. So today you may have a particular type of requirement. Maybe after few years, 2 years or 5 years, you may have a different type of requirement. So there is a need and there is a situation where you have to change your portfolio. That is called reviewing the portfolio. Because if your investment objectives changes, then naturally you have to review your portfolio. Otherwise, you will not get the desired results. So, and the final one is evaluate the performance of the portfolio. So after investing everything and doing all these 4 steps, unless you evaluate the performance, whether you are getting the desired performance or not, you will know only when you analyze these things. So it is maybe as an investor, an individual investor, a corporate investor, whoever may be the case, they have to follow this particular 5-step process. This is the way you invest in a scientific manner. If you are not following means, then you are just trying to hit in the bush, and maybe you may be successful, you may not be successful. So there is a great element of risk. So a scientific investment process is involved in these 5 steps. The next thing is, topic in this particular unit is the financial environment. When you say financial environment, there are 3 components, the financial institutions, the financial markets, and the financial instruments. Instruments are various, as we discussed in the previous session, equity shares, debentures, warrants, futures, options, government securities, bank deposits. I am just confining this particular discussion into the financial assets. So there is a whole lot of different types of instruments involved. Financial institutions, again, in the process of converting your saving into investment, there is a huge lot of different types of investment institutions involved. And not only the financial institutions, but regulatory institutions, the merchant bankers, the issue managers. You will be able to understand these things better when you go further into these courses. As you study further the units, you will be understanding it. Since we don't have much time, we are very quickly covering these things. So all these institutions are involved. Then the financial markets. Financial markets refers to the capital market or the money market. Money market is broadly the short-term investment options. There are short-term investments in the options in the money market, and finally, capital market involves long-term investments and long-term strategies. Similarly, there is another classification: primary markets and secondary markets. So these are the things. So within the broad three frameworks of the investment environment, one would be operating and the investment process, the whole process from postponing consumption, then savings, then investment. This simple process involves so many things. So there is a mix of instruments for investments and the market. So these are the different types of investments we have. So one can see that there are different characteristics of different instruments. So I will not be very elaborately dealing with them. You can study it from your material and other places. So with this remarks, I think I will request my colleague to make a presentation on the risk, different types of risk and nature of risk. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Today we are going to talk about the components of investment risk. Now when we are talking about the risk part, we are clearly faced with the four scenario. One scenario is the one in which we have uncertainty about the future condition which is going to prevail in the market. The second scenario is the one in which we are ignorant about the future scenario which is going to be there. And the other two scenarios are the one in which we are certain but within a range. Let us say that we are going to estimate whether the Indian economy is going to grow by how much percent. So we are not very much certain it is going to grow by 8% or 9% or 10%. But we are certain in the sense from the previous figures which we have that it is going to grow between a range of 7 to 9%. That much we are certain, but we are not certain about the exact point, whether it is going to be 8.5 or 8.7 or something like that. Similarly, when we are talking about the companies, what is going to be their earning growth, what is going to be their dividend, etc. By going to their previous track record, we can know whether what is going to be their earning growth, but that too within a range. That means that it can be within range of 10-20% or 20-25%, but we cannot be certain about the fact whether it is going to be 22% or 21%. So these are the four scenarios regarding how much information we have about the future. Now with each of these scenarios, there is the quantum of the risk which is associated with each of the scenario is quite different. When we are totally ignorant about the future and we based on our ignorance we are going based on the ignorance if you are going to invest, the amount of the risk is going to be quite high. But when we are certain about the future, where we know what is going to be the probable outcome within a range, then the amount of the risk associated with the investment decisions based on these type of information, the risk is going to be quite low or which can be controlled. So these are the various type of risk. Now this other important thing is how to measure this risk. Now when we are talking about how to measure this risk, we have two main instruments or two main techniques through which we are going to measure the risk, especially with reference to the financial securities. One is the expected value and another one is the standard deviation. Now when we are talking about the expected value, the formula for calculating the expected value is going to be expected value is equal to I is equal to 1 to N. That means the where xi is the possible return and pxi is the probability of occurrence of xi, that is the probability of the occurrence of the probable return. Now this formula will become more clear to you when you see this particular table. Now in this particular table we are taking two companies, company A and B, where we have the expected return, which is denoted by ri, that is ranging from 6 to 10%, and the probability associated with each expected return, that there is going to be an expected return of 6%, the probability is 10%. With the expected return of 7%, we have a probability of 25%. With the expected return of 8%, there is a probability of 30%, and so on and so forth. Now when we have to find out in this scenario where we have the different expected returns within a range and the probability which is associated with each of the expected return, then the expected return which is going to be there is going to be, what we do is we multiply the expected return with the probability associated with that particular expected return. In this particular case, in the case of company A, what we have done, we have multiplied 6 by 0.10. We have got 0.6. Similarly, what we have done in the second case, where we have expected return of 7%, what we have done is we have multiplied 7 by 0.25, which is the 0.25 is the probability that there is going to be a return of 7%. So we have got 1.75. So we have in this way we have calculated for all the values which are within a range the expected return for each of these values, and the next step is to sum up these. If you look at this particular formula of the expected value, what we have, I is equal 1 to n, this is the sign of summation, where xi, here see the xi and ri are same. In the table we have taken the ri, whereas in the formula we have taken the xi. So what we have done in order to get the expected value is we multiply each of the expected return by the probability associated with that particular expected return, and we sum up all those figures in order to get the expected value. This is the first step. Now the second technique to measure the riskiness. Now in this particular case we have taken two companies. So in case of company A, we have already discussed. In the case of company B, again you see that is within the expected returns are within a range of 4 to 12%, but here again the final expected returns are going to come to 8%, and here again now if you compare this company A and company B, the range, if you compare the range of the expected returns, one is starting from 6 and ending at 10, whereas in the case of company B it is starting from 4 and ending at 12. Now if you look at this particular range, which is the range which is having a higher dispersion, it is obviously company B. Now which of the company is going to be riskier, that we have to find out, whether we should invest in the shares of the company A or whether we should invest in the shares of company B. Now in order to find out, the tool which we are going to use is the standard deviation. Now the formula for this standard deviation is again sigma is equal to, that is a notion for the standard deviation, I is equal to summation I is equal to 2n, pi, that is the probability associated with the ijth return, into ri, that is the ijth return, minus er, that is the expected return which we have already calculated in our previous slide. Whole square, this ri minus er, that is expected return, this is squared and then multiplied by the probability associated with the rth ith return. Now let us see, for company A we are going to calculate the standard deviation. Now we have already calculated the expected return, which is 8%. So this is we have taken this is in table form. Now RIPI you have already know. Now the third step is to calculate the difference between the expected return, the final expected return, and the expected return. Now we have calculated in the case of company A, we have calculated the expected return as 8%, and here we are taking as 6%. So 8 minus 6, that is minus 2. 8 minus 7, minus 1. In this way we have calculated these values. Now in what we do is we square this in order to get a positive number. What we do is we square this, so we square this particular value, that comes out to be 4 1 0 1 and 4. Now the if you look at the formula, what we have to calculate, PI into RI minus ER raised to 2. So in the last column we are calculating this PI into brackets open I minus expected return brackets closed this raised to 2, that we have calculated. Now and adding up this, since there is a summation notation over there, adding up this we get 1.3. now but since if you notice in the formula, it is in the this whole is under root. So what we do is, in order to calculate this 1.3, we take the under root of 1.3, which comes out to be 1.14. So the standard deviation of this particular returns is 1.14. Now in the case of company B, again starting with the same process, we get 4.8, and taking the under root of 4.8 we get 2.19. so in the case of company A, your standard deviation was 1.14, and in the case of company B, your standard deviation was 2.19. So the returns of those companies which are having a lower standard deviation, they are less risky. So this is one of the techniques which we are using to find out the riskiness of a particular company, the cash flows associated with a particular company. Now let us talk about the evolution of the risk connotations. Now when we are talking about the risk connotations, early in the 20th century, when industry was gradually evolving, whenever the analyst used to do the security analysis of a particular company, the most important thing which he used to look was the capital structure, how the company is being financed. If the capital structure contained a higher amount of debt, then the analyst used to categorize those companies as risky companies. So in the early part of the development of the security valuations, the yardstick which was used to classify a company, whether this company is a risky company or whether it is not a risky company, one of the major yardstick was how much the debt has been employed in the capital structure of the company. As you all know, you have already studied that the capital structure of the company consists of the equity shares and the debt which the company has taken broadly. Now then in the 1960s, Graham, Dord and Cottle gave another concept for assessing the riskiness of a particular security, and that was the margin of the safety. Now when we are talking about the margin of the safety, in order to find out the margin of the safety, they said the first, the analyst should find out what is the intrinsic value of that particular security or that particular company. Now, there can be various parameters for finding out the intrinsic value. One parameter can be what is the earning of the company, what is going to be the future earning of the company. Through that, one can find out the intrinsic value. Another parameter can be what is the amount of the capital assets which has been employed by the company. Now, let's take the example of our public undertakings. Prior to this investment, the public sector, the shares of the public sector companies were being traded at a very low price. I still remember that in the 90s, 94, 95, even 96, the share of the Securities Authority of India was 3 rupees, 4 or 5 or within this range. But today it is being traded at rupees 160, 150. So what has happened within this span of these 7 years? Nothing very important. One, the company has reduced all the amount of the debt which it has taken has reduced. But the intrinsic value of that company was the amount of the capital assets and the land which it was having was enormous. But since at that particular point of time, due to the heavy amount of the loans which they had taken, the company was not making that much of profit. That at that particular point of time, that the share price of that particular share was being quoted rupees 5 and 6. But now it is making profit. That's why it's being traded at. So the in nutshell, what I want to say is, first the analyst should look at the what is the intrinsic value of the company. Secondly, what is the market value of the company? The difference between these two, the intrinsic value of the company and the market value of the company, is called as the margin of safety. The companies having the greater margin of the safety would be less riskier as compared to the companies having lesser margin of safety. Then when we are talking about risk, it is also important to talk about systematic and non-systematic risk. Now when we are talking about the systematic risk, these are the risks which are all pervasive. When I say it is all pervasive, that means these are the risks which are there in the economy. It is not that one particular company is going to be faced by this particular risk and other company is going to be insulated from that risk. Now, the example of this risk may be the rise in the interest rate. Now, whenever there is going to be a rise in the interest rate, all the companies are going to be uniformly affected by the rise in the interest rate. Another type of the risk is the recession in the economy. Whenever there is going to be a recession in the economy, all the companies are going to be affected. So, this is a type of systematic risk. Now, the non-systematic risks are those risks which are for a particular company or a particular industry. Now, let us say, for example, now what we are seeing is the price of the crude oil is going up. Now, this kind of risk would be more acute for the companies which are there in the refining sector and the marketing of oil products. So, this type of risk is going to be not all for all the companies which are operating in the economy or the country. It is going to be more acute for the companies which are there in the refining and the marketing of oil product sector. So, this is going to be a non-systematic risk. Now, these two type of risk are additive in nature. That is that they are not exclusive in nature, they are additive in nature. Total risk which the company is going to face is going to be the sum of the systematic and non-systematic risk. Now, another technique which we used to measure risk of a particular company is the beta of that particular company. The beta measures the responsiveness of the changes in the price of a company relative to the overall changes in the key indices of that particular market. Now let us say if the beta of a particular company is 1.5 and the benchmark index of that particular the benchmark index has risen by 100%. That implies that if the benchmark has risen by 1%, the price of that particular security which is having a beta of 1.5 is going to rise by 1.5 times more. That means, let us say, if that particular security is being quoted at rupees 100 and the market has risen by 10%, then this particular security is going to rise by 15%, that is, it will be quoted at or traded at rupees 115. So that is one type of the techniques which we are using for measuring the risk of a particular company. Now, let us talk about the various type of risks which make up the total risk. Interest rate risk. Now, when we are talking about the interest rate risk, it is a risk faced by the companies who have taken loans from banks and financial institutions. Now, in case if the rates go up, then the amount of the interest outgo is going to go up, thereby affecting the amount of the income which is going to be available to the ordinary shareholders. Since the amount of the interest which the company is going to pay is going to be more, that's why the net profit is going to be less. Therefore, the even the dividends are going to be less, the capital appreciation of that particular script is going to be less. That is the interest rate risk, the risk which is associated with the fluctuation in the interest rates in the economy. Now, we have recently witnessed this type of risk. Few months back in January, what has happened? The Reserve Bank of India has raised the various interest rates. As a consequence of that, what has happened? The rates, the banks which were giving loans, they have also jacked up their interest rates. As a consequence of that, what had happened? The persons or the companies who were taking loans, they had to pay higher amount of interest. And in some cases, even the capital investments were postponed. The persons who were planning to buy a new car, a new house, they were postponed. That implies that the consumption in the economy had decreased. Now, whenever the consumption in the economy is going to decrease, what is going to happen? The companies are going to be directly affected. So, that is one of the risks being faced by the various companies. Now, it is another matter. How the company, whether the companies are uniformly affected or not. There may be some companies who are smart enough to take the loans from overseas bodies. Now, when they are taking the loans from overseas bodies, what is happening is there is an interest rate differential. Now, in case of India, they are getting the loans at 9% rate of interest. If they are taking loans from either London or America, they are getting somewhere LIBOR plus 1.5%, and the LIBOR is the London interbank offer rate, that is somewhere around 4.5% plus 1.5%, that comes to 6%, then 1% they have to pay for the premium for the fluctuation in the exchange rate, so it's somewhere it comes out to be 7%, there is a differential of 2%. So it depends how the companies are managing their debts also. All the companies are not going to be uniformly affected by the interest rate risk. It will depend upon how the companies are managing their debts also. Now, another type of risk is your market risk. Now, if you look at the Bombay Stock Exchange Sensex, the benchmark index of past few days, what we have seen is one day it falls by 500 points, another day it rises by 300 points, again it falls by 600 points, then again it rises by a couple of 100 points and like that. Now, in this type of scenario where what you see is the prices of the securities going up and down so rapidly. So again, if we are talking from investment point of view, if a particular company or a person or an individual has invested in the equities and the prices are fluctuating so widely, so this is precisely your market risk. Market risk is the risk associated with the fluctuation in the prices of the securities or with the fluctuation in the benchmark index. Because now what has happened is after the introduction of options and futures in the Indian market, most of the securities are being traded in the future and option mode also. So depending upon how you have invested, the market risk is going to affect you. Now, the instruments to contain the market risk are again your futures and options. Now, if you have bought something in the cash segment, what do you use the future of that particular script in the future and options segment? So in that way, you can minimize the market risk. Now, another risk is inflation risk. Now, when we are talking about the inflation risk basically means that the purchasing power of the rupee or the purchasing power is going down. Now, let us take a scenario where the real rate, coupon rate, that is the interest rate which is prevailing in the economy is R. See, in order to find out the impact of the inflation risk or in order to measure the inflation risk, let us take a scenario where the prevailing inflation in the market is 10% and the rate of the interest which the banks are giving on deposits, I am saying the rate of interest which the banks are giving on deposits is 8%, that we refer to as coupon point, the coupon yield in our slide. Now, if you invest this, your savings at a rate of interest of 8% and the prevailing inflation rate is 10%, are you really earning something? Now, in order to find out whether are you really earning something or not, what we do, we put these values in our equation, that is RR, that is the real effective rate, where RR is equal to 1 plus R plus upon 1 plus Q minus 1. Now, R is 8%, Q is 10%. Now, when we put simplify this particular equation, we get minus 2. So, in fact, when the inflation is high in the economy, you are not earning something, but in fact, you are losing something. Although you may be getting 108 rupees after a period of 1 year, but the real worth of that 108 rupees would be rupees 98 as of today, not even rupees 100. So inflation risk is the risk associated with the increase in the prices. Now again, how the companies are going to be affected? Obviously, the raw material is going to become dearer, the wages are going to become dearer. In that way, again, the profits are going to decline. The next risk, especially in the context of the investment, is the default risk. Now, the default risk is the risk associated with the bank or the financial institution or the company in which you have made deposit not paying interest and not returning the principal amount, or not paying the interest or returning the principal amount on time. Now let us assume that you have invested in a particular company in A, that too in the form of debt instruments. So when you are invested to debt instrument, what is going to happen? You are entitled for interest plus repayment of your principal amount. Now if at any point of time the company refuses to pay you interest or delays in paying you the interest, then that is a default risk. So especially in the context of the default risk, in the context of the investment, the default risk is the non-payment of interest and principal amount by the institution in which you have invested or by the institution in whose securities you have invested. Then another type of risk is the business risk. Now when we are talking about the business risk, as you all know, the economy runs in a cyclic mode. Cyclic mode means at some point of time there is recession and at some point of time there is a boom. So depending upon the economy is in which phase, whether it is in the growth phase, whether it is in the recession phase, whether it is in the stagflation phase, the business risk is there. Now if it is in the growth phase, the business risk is going to be low. But after the growth phase, if it comes, the growth curve becomes like a plateau, that means growth is not there, then the business risk associated with those sectors where growth is very low or negligible is going to be high. So again, if you have invested in those kind of sectors, what is going to happen? Your investment is going to be affected by the business risk associated with those particular sectors. Now if we go to a decade back, at that particular point of time, the computer software industry was in great demand, and those who have invested in those particular sectors have made a lot of money. And at that particular point of time, what has happened? The so-called traditional industries, especially the industries which were of highly capital intensive nature, steel making, refineries and all that, they were going into recession, but this particular sector was booming. So depending upon in which sector you have invested, what is the growth curve of that sector, the risk is going to be associated with that particular sector. The next one is the financial risk. The financial risk is again somewhat similar to your default risk, that the financial risk is the the financial risk is the non-commitment, honoring the commitments, the financial commitments which the company has already made. So again, it is kind of your default risk where the company fails to pay or fails to meet its required financial